I'm Daniel Zengel with PRP Labs here with Don Lipscomb, and we're going to be discussing how platelet-rich plasma injections have been shown to help patients with osteochondral lesions of the talus, which is related to ankle arthritis.
Yeah.
And so this is something that's common in athletes. It's common in people who have sprained their ankle time and time again. It's just that the ankle, Don, correct me if I'm wrong, there's probably not a lot of vascularity and blood flow in the ankle. And
no, whenever you're talking about joint cavities and stuff in particular, then they're very avascular structures.
Right.
Yeah.
And so as cartilage degrades, you can actually see lesions develop on the bones, and this can lead to all kinds of symptoms, pain, stiffness, soreness. And so in this study that Don's going to be speaking about, the researchers compared platelet-rich plasma injections with a more common therapy, which would be a hyaluronic acid injection. And can you tell us a bit about the study, Don?
Sure. So the reason why they wanted to compare it with hyaluronic acid is because that's one of the most common treatments, you know, for osteoarthritis. However, it doesn't really solve the problem, right? It's like just slapping a Band-Aid on the wound and then not doctoring it up properly.
It's like, probably not harmful in any way to the patients, but it's more like treating the symptoms, trying to get lubrication in there to reduce friction.
Exactly. So there are 29 patients, and so none of these patients had responded to any types of other treatment. So they didn't respond to anti-inflammatories or weight-bearing exercises or orthotic provisions, sort of like a brace that you put on the ankle. They all ranged in age from 18 to 60, so, you know, you had some young athletes probably in there, and then some people had probably been suffering from, you know, osteoarthritis for quite some time. And they were given either an intra-articular injection of hyaluronic acid or PRP.
Right.
So it was just a direct comparison between the two.
And I did notice there's a couple quirks in this study as far as the research design. So the researchers felt that it would be prudent to do a different schedule for the PRP injections and the hyaluronic acid injections. And they have their reasons. I mean, they looked at past research and concluded that hyaluronic acid is more often done once a week.
Yes.
PRP is more often done every 2 weeks. So what they did is they gave all the patients either a hyaluronic acid or PRP injection on day one. And then for the hyaluronic acid, it was on 7 days later and 14 days later, whereas the PRP, it was day one and then 14 days later and 28 days later. So a little interesting. I think it might hurt the credibility of the study a little bit to be spacing out the treatments differently. You know, what do you think?
Yeah, I mean, that's just confounding it with one more variable.
Right.
I mean, but ultimately, you know, well, let's look at the result.
Right.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. So a little bit, just a bit of background on the PRP itself. So 18 milliliter blood draw. Sodium citrate is an anticoagulant.
Right.
It's pretty common. So centrifuge, the tubes were then centrifuged for 8 minutes. So they said that they specifically collected the top layer just above the buffy coat. So they wanted to make sure that they weren't getting all the leukocytes in there.
Yeah. And if you are just doing a single spin with a centrifuge, because some kits, they'll do one spin, and then you take the whole supernatant all the way up to the buffy coat and spin that again to form a pellet of platelets at the bottom. If you're just doing a single spin, we know that the densest concentration of platelets is directly above the buffy coat. So they at least had their mind in the right place with that technique.
And so they hypothesized this was 2 to 3 times over baseline, which, I mean, the difference between 2x and 3x could be quite significant.
Yeah,
but,
yeah, the researchers did not do a platelet count before and afterwards. They probably just didn't have the resources.
Yeah, probably not. But, I mean, it's not for all clinics to be able to do that.
Right,
you know?
Yeah. But they went from 18 milliliters of blood to 2 milliliters of PRP. So saying they got 2 or 3 times concentration, I mean,
it's
unrealistic. Yeah.
Especially since, and so another thing they did, so they activated the PRP before injection.
Right. As the study said, they activated the PRP with calcium chloride, and I quote, seconds before the injection, as not to form the platelet-rich fibrin before they inject it.
Exactly. But so they thought that, you know, upon activation, so platelets degranulate, and this also catalyzes the conversion of fibrogen to fibrin. And so what this does is it forms like a scaffold structure. So they were thinking it would capture the platelets and then allow them to slowly degranulate into the joint cavity over time, because as we have learned, some growth factors will will be expressed within the first hour.
Right.
But then some, it's like a slow, steady progression for up to 7 days.
Right.
So that, I mean, I think that that was a good idea.
Right,
overall.
Yeah. And it seemed to work, right? Mm-hmm. So in this study, they were measuring the patient's improvement at 4 weeks, 12 weeks, and 28 weeks. They're looking at functional assessment mm-hmm. scores as well as a visual analog pain score. And the patients showed statistically significant improvement in the PRP group at 4 weeks, 12 weeks, and 28 weeks.
Yeah, and overall, I mean, I think it was a pretty good study. However, there were just a few extra variables in there that, you know, I guess more research, you know.
Yeah, and you know, it's nice that they did a 28-week follow-up because even though the PRP and the hyaluronic acid were slightly different schedules, by, you know, week four, everyone had gotten everything was done. So if you're looking at this 28 weeks later and you're still seeing statistically significant improvement in the PRP group, to me that kind of assures me a little bit more that that does seem like a more effective treatment.
And this also backs up what we've seen before with osteochondral lesions of other areas of the body, you know.
Right.
Like, it seems to be more effective than hyaluronic acid, this PRP, this PRP injection.
Yes.
So it's kind of just more research to back up other research.
Absolutely. So. Yeah. All right, Don, thank you. So
thank you.
One more notch on the board for PRP, and we're going to come back with another video here in a minute. So stay tuned, and we will be back.